Hello boys and girls, in this video we are going to talk about lazy lists in Python for Cauchy sequences and in the definition of real numbers. But before we get into that, let me give a shout out and an invitation. Internet colleague of mine called Largo organizes on Discord a reading group on Lie-algebras and Lie groups. We are going to use the book by Brian C. Hall. I already made here this YouTube post invitation 2 days ago. The book is called Lie Groups, Lie Algebras and Representations. I think this is more or less established text, and we are going to meet on Saturdays and going to go through examples, and Lago usually gives some presentations and we are going to discuss the exercises, and I'm also going to do it. And if you're interested in that, and if you can stomach a few edgy people, but mostly very nice, then follow the Discord link. It will be in the description box below. I'm not sure if this link that I posted here 2 days ago is still valid, but the one in the box, if you see this video, will be. Okay, and so I was motivated to make this video somewhat in the relation to Lie groups as well. Of course, I have already made videos on Lie groups, especially like rotation stuff on this YouTube channel. And one of the simplest, maybe the second simplest Lie group is the group of rotations in two dimensions. This is a one-dimensional compact Lie group. SO2 or U1 are two representations by the 2x2 matrices or complex numbers with norm 1 or determinant 1. And there is an object related to this Lie group, which I really like, called the group of rational points on the unit circle. So for sure, like, let's think of the complex numbers with norm 1. These numbers represented as e to the power of I times a, where a is some angle going from 0 to 2 pi. And the parameter for the Lie group in general is this real number, right? So they have this angle, and for every angle, for every value in this interval, you get a group element, and you know how to multiply the complex numbers, of course. And the interesting thing is here that there are points that in this group, you can think of the complex numbers as R2, like two-dimensional real Euclidean space with this product. And of course, as a subset of R2 is Q2, the rational numbers, the pairs of rational numbers. And then it's clear that there are some rational points on this circle of complex numbers. Because the number 1, right, it has components 1 and 0, is a rational point. It has two components, which are both rational number, even integers. And so 1, 0 is a point in the complex plane which is rational and on the circle. And so is 0, 1, right? 0 in the x direction, 1 in the y direction is also a rational point. And minus 1, 0 and 0, minus 1. These are like these four points on the on these extremal points with respect to the Euclidean metric, these are on a circle and they're rational. But you might ask, are there more? And indeed, there are infinitely many more, and these correspond to Pythagorean triples. I'm not going to really talk about these rational points much, but what is nice about them is that they are like rational, like these finite objects. A rational number is basically two natural numbers, if you will. You know, up to the common denominator that is always cancelled out when you pass to the quotient. And because they are the rational points, they are actually then dense, are a subset of all of these Lie group elements. The multiplication works, and you actually stay then in these rational numbers. So there's this very interesting like group of cardinality of the real numbers, so uncountably many points, each of which is given by two natural numbers in various representations, and you can multiply them together. This is very cute. And what I was interested a few days ago was considering Cauchy sequences in this group of rational points, you know, rational coordinate points in this plane, if you will. Cauchy sequence that, i.e., as a sequence of such points which converge against a value, and I want that the value is not actually an element of the group, which means effectively, like one way of doing it is to have a sequence of points in this circle, each point of which is a rational number, the pair of rational numbers. I talked about two natural numbers represent the rational number, and of course there is like two rational number for each point, right? The components are each component is a rational number, each rational number is given by two natural numbers, so you're not confused here. So a sequence of rational numbers on the circle which has a limit point which is not in the group, which is not a rational number. I want to construct such a thing. And this is the direction in which this video goes. However, I will not talk about actually the unit circle in this video. I will keep it for a moment to Cauchy sequences just on the rational number line if you want. And so in this video, we are going to use the lazy lists, the infinite lists in Python. This is like a built-in standard library feature to have yield this lists, and this is what I also talked about in the video 7 days ago. And we are going to represent Cauchy sequences with these infinite streams, as opposed to last week that we represented formal power series, like whole functions, as infinite streams, and then we had some operations on these infinite streams corresponding to integration, differentiation, addition, and so on. In this video, conceptually, actually a little bit easier, because we are going to be interested in just these coefficients which converge against a certain number, and we're going to be using the number pi. So here is a Wikipedia article called Lists of Formula Involving Pi, right? So here you have a bunch of formulas that are pi, and the next few minutes is the most difficult part in this video, because I want to emphasize the in the definition of the real numbers as Cauchy real numbers, right? This Cauchy real number model that you might consider set theoretical, but that's not so much the point here. It's a collection of sequences which all converge against the same value, right? So here, if you go on the construction of the real numbers section for the Cauchy sequences, that we talk about sets of Cauchy sequences. Cauchy just means they converge against, basically they converge against the same value, they get closer and closer to each other, right? So this is more implicit than speaking about values. It's about sequences which get closer and closer in the metric sense. Cauchy sequences of rational numbers, and if you take all these sequences which have the same limit point, i.e. which get closer and closer, and I don't really want to talk about limit points because I'm defining the real numbers here, then these sequences, the collection of sequences, they are infinite, uncountable actually, sets of sequences of rational numbers, meaning where the elements, each element of the sequence is a rational number. All the collection of all those which come closer and closer to each other, those are defined as a real number, right? So every real number here is this infinite set of sequences. And I emphasize this a little bit to emphasize that we talk about sequences in the rational numbers, right? The sequences in the rational numbers are elements of individual real numbers. I want to emphasize again that if you look at the Wikipedia article on the Cauchy sequences, right, they are like the first example is the real numbers, right? These are Cauchy sequences in the real numbers. But that's not what we talk about here. We don't talk about as an infinite sequence where every entry can be a generic real number, even if they are converged to some value. We talk about sequences in rational numbers, which define what a real number even is, right? So in this way, if we code up an infinite stream, some implementation, you know, it's very constructive, saying how to compute every coefficients one after the other in this sequence, then we actually don't even have a real number this way. We have a representative. We are in this set theoretical model of the Cauchy reals. We have an element of a real number. So if I compute an algorithm that approaches pi, quotes and quotes, that goes against a certain value, then this is merely an element in the set that is pi, right? So the language here is a little bit fuzzy. You know, you can say this Cauchy sequences approaches pi, but I don't want to say that here because I think of the sequence as setting up what pi is. And so what I do really is I will give you two implementations, two infinite sequences. In analysis, these sequences are provably approaching the same point, i.e. they are provably getting closer and closer together. And these are two elements of pi. Okay, so what are the implementations that we are going to use? Well, we are going to have algorithmic implementations of certain sums and products that give pi. The first one is the Leibniz formula, which is this infinite sum. If you take it times four, then you get pi, right? So the sum is 1 minus 1 over an uneven number, then the sign flips, +1 over, and then the same uneven number, +2, and then minus, the sign has flipped again, the uneven number, again +2, and so on and so forth. We are going to compute these bit by bit. We are going to have an object, which is like a class, it's like an object-oriented programming type of class which has some member functions, and so we keep track where we are, and we're going to spit out better and better approximations by adding this inverse integers, and we're going to yield it in this Python sense, and then always before we return it, multiply it by 4, so we actually get an approximation of pi this way. And the other one is similar, called the Wallis product, which is defined as 2 times this infinite product, where each factor, and we're going to compute the factors one after the other and multiply it to what we already got, where the factor is this number, which is always a little bit bigger than 1, right? So we compute for every n, 4 times n squared, right? For 3, this is 4 times 9, divided by the same number -1. So this is a little bit smaller, so the whole factor is a little bit bigger than 1, and we compute a bunch of factors which are all close to 1, but in the end, if it's multiplied by 2, they end up giving 3.14159 something. Okay, and by the way, both of these approximations are, you know, not great approximations of pi. Here we see a bunch of other like formula to get at it, which are much more like faster converging. We are at this page, you know, I want to emphasize that if you speak of Cauchy sequence or in the rational numbers which converges to pi, then really you must have one algorithm for computing pi already in mind, one definition of pi, even if it's a geometrical one where the circumference divided by 2 times the ratio, some algorithm which computes this number, and then a Cauchy sequence which converges to pi. You can only really formulate this as it gets closer and closer to the other sequence that you defined as the definitional way of computing pi, right? What we are also going to do at the end of this video is we are going to compute cosine of pi in this stream sense. And the interesting thing here is that we're going to be always like exact. We are going to be have a sequence again in the rational numbers, a sequence in the rational numbers which converges against cosine of pi. And the interesting thing here is that, of course, you know, in an analysis you can prove then that in this theory this is minus one. You know, they have the half circle of pi, and the cosine of this is the x coordinate, and this is exactly minus one. Cosine of pi is minus one. We're going to do plug in the Cauchy rational number into this function. And the fun thing about this function is this is also a function which gives you a priori transcendental values, right? So this function, the cosine, I have it here, is also given as an infinite series. So we have, let's say, the Wallis product, the infinite product, and this infinite series, and we must combine them in somehow, so in some way that this actually approaches pi, which means we must be more exact on both ends, on the input, which is given as the stream, and as the function, which is also given as the stream. The return value of the function is also given as the stream. So we're going to code this up in a way that we actually get better and better approximation on both, on the input value and on the function computation value. And we're going to use this successive polynomial approximation of cosine that is given here, right? This also has flipping signs and positive, like even exponent of the input value, and this input value is going to be get better and better with each yield, with each you know, output along the stream. Okay, so with that said, let's get into it, right? So this is the script that I'm going to go through. I have here this link to the list of formulas involving pi. Of course, as always, the script here, this whole text that I use is in the description box below. And today you also find the link to this Discord reading group. Yeah, speaking about this article, you know, I want to emphasize also here that what did we have it here? Yeah, here, this is also like this sort of situation, right? It looks nice and simple, right? This pi is given as this integral, but here are two things that are infinite in some capacity, right? So the Riemann integral is some limit of a sequence where each entry is a sum, and in this sum, the each summand, as opposed to the cosine computation, here the summands actually change from entry to entry, right? Because in every entry, in every step n, you actually divide by a different number to get the better approximation. So this is quite the involved algorithmic object. And also the square root is also, you know, you can view this as for, you know, generic input values. Maybe you want to compute it in this kind of this Greek way of computing a fixed point. There are various algorithms. There's also a Wikipedia page, by the way, for computing square root of pi, which is nice. And so here we have sort of two limit processes, actually. This computing this also needs, like, computing it numerically anyway, already requires you to think about how to actually fuse these two infinite processes. So that's just as an aside. Okay, so here I use three libraries. The first two are not super necessary, but the first one, I use it to actually look at the value, the reference implementation of pi in the math library here, so that we have a reference value. And this, and also for the factorial function, because this is also not in the standard library without importing anything. Then the time library, I use this to make breaks during the printouts, right? If I don't sleep, then the terminal would be like spammed with information, and so I sleep. This is not essential for the computation in any way either. I also use the fraction library, which makes sure that I can keep on using rational numbers and having not cast a float, right? A floating number has a certain number of bits, and if you compute the fraction of two natural numbers that are huge, then on a computer, if you want to store it in a in a fixed size, fixed byte size object, then you must you lose information, right? By the pigeonhole principle, you cannot store infinitely different numbers, rational numbers, in the same countable size, finite size storage. And so what the rational ratio, this is a basically division, I could also call it div. What it does is, it does not cast a float, it actually keeps the net, then if you divide two natural numbers, it actually keeps the natural numbers up to the greatest common denominator, which it divides out. So naturally, for example, I will implement the Wallis product here, right? And I will also give actually two implementations. The first one, it's the more straightforward one. The second one, I actually keep the numerator and denominator. And so this will be numbers which blow up like crazy, even if we divide out these natural number that blow up like crazy, even if we divide out the common denominators. I actually tried it, doesn't help. Okay, so what do we have here? We have these three streams, these three numbers. The Leibniz one, the Wallis number, I'm going to go through them in detail in a second. And then the second implementation where I keep the numerator and denominator, denom, that should be, I guess. And then I have a printing function which prints out this all of those. Then I'm going to compute this cosine of pi. I have written here, it's more accurate. Here's this function which takes this, it takes a function that computes the terms in a series. So this is going to be taking these terms here, these individual terms, and it takes this number as a stream and fuses them together in the kind of obvious way. I implement the cosine here, and then I'm also going to print it and we will learn something. Okay. So, let's see what it tells me to go to sleep. What do we have here? Well, the implementation of this the Leibniz one is straightforward. What I do is I use this stream to have this ongoing infinite series and the ongoing infinite sequence. And how the yield keyword works, right? I explained this in this video a week ago in more detail. That's why I will not repeat it here. Essentially, you start an infinite process. There's going to be, like, in principle, ongoing. This while true is always true. It will always execute this, and then you yield or return this entries one after the other, and this thing is lazy in the sense that it will not, like, block you. It, just because it's an infinite process, just because it says while true, doesn't mean that once you call this function the computer explodes. Instead, you pop out elements from the infinite sequence as you need them, or you do a for loop over it, and it's smart enough to always give you just what you want. Okay, so again, sorry for this jumping around. So what do? We treat the stream sort of like a class, like an object-oriented programming class. We have this member variables, which are the status where we are. Like, on the one hand, the index where we are in the approximation, and on the other hand, the rational number that is the approximation to it. So we start actually with 0 and then add 1 and then subtract 1 over 3, then add 1 over 5 and so on and so forth. And this is exactly what happens here. So this is the sum, it starts at 0. We have a sign that, as you see here, flips at every iteration. We keep track of where we are, that's the index. And this is raised at every iteration. then what happens is that we yield what we have till now times 4. The times 4 is simply that bringing the 4 on the other side and to get pi and not pi over 4. And then after the yielding, we could also do it before, we compute the next s that we are going to return. So we compute the denominator. These are these uneven numbers which grow with each iteration. And then we divide, right? We have the sign divided by this denominator, and we add this new small fraction 1 over something, or plus minus 1 over something, to the s. And this is how the game goes. Okay, and similar this product, right? We start with a product. I explained this is like multiplying a lot of terms which are a little bit bigger than 1. We start with 1, as you always do with this infinite approximations of products, of infinite products. You have a counter here as well. In this case, I started at 1. Same spiel. I have started as infinite product. I return 2 times, in this case, p is a product, and 2 because that's how it's defined. And I compute the numerator, which is this 4 times n squared. You know, if you compute more and more elements in the product, this kind of grows like 4 to the power of n times n factorial squared, something like that. Like it grows faster than a factorial, huge numbers. At every iteration, it grows multiplicatively, and then I multiply this p by this number, which is a little bit bigger than 1. And so this will from the start at 1 and then grow till 3.14 and so on. I'm losing my voice. Okay, I have the similar implementation here. It's basically doing the same thing, except I don't divide, I don't use this ratio, but I actually keep these rationals. I actually implemented it like this because I needed for the other video on this the rational points in on the circle. But so this is the same implementation. I also tried to like cancel the common denominator, but this barely helped in keeping the size of these natural numbers small, or the size of the integers. So I commented it out. You can, the point is here that if you multiply these separately, then you have redundancy in that every common denominator would cancel out once you pass to the rational number anyway. But I learned that doesn't really matter much in this case. Okay, and then the first main function is using this zip, which like joins lists or streams, and gives you for every index all of these joined streams return values or yielded values at once. So what this does is, if you loop over it like I do here, then you can pop up simultaneously all the elements for the index. So I pop up the Leibniz sum, the Wallis product, and then this more complicated Wallis product where I didn't divide. And we can already do that. So I have here my command line. This is pointed at this script. And if I execute it, then every second here, I have here the sleep. Every second it pops up another, iteration for both these implementations. By the way, here I have this s, this p, and then I also have here the reference pi. This is the Python library implementation. And what we see here is, of course, the pi that I always put out is by definition, just a constant. It's just this one floating point number. And here are these two approximations, rational approximations, cast to a float, one after the other. We can also then, let's actually go to 0.3 here, okay? And I will stop this process here. What I want for you is, think about it. The Leibniz one has this flipping signs, so naturally it will jump up and down much faster. It will jump actually at all. It will go up and down. Whereas the Wallis product always just goes up. It starts at one and then slowly goes up. And so it looks much more stable. And you can actually see this then in, here in the result. Yeah? If you could look at the first line with the Leibniz, and you see how it always goes check, 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 up and down. It quickly is there. Here it jumps at this moment, like at N20, between 0 and 1. And now this is fixed. And the next one, this is actually cute. But well, this is like much more stable. I think both are bad approximations. I'm not sure which one is worse. It looks to me that the Wallace product is maybe a little bit better. I don't know. Yeah, so that's how it goes. Let me also print the... Here I have a test that the third implementation of the Wallace one is giving the right result as well. This is just an assert. Let me actually print the product. Let's go with the product as a rational number, right? This is the implementation of the Wallace product, and I've just printed like so, just to see how fast these rationals grow, right? So these are this approximation. This value is just this value, but not cast to float. And then you see how it grows. Yeah, so you see, I have this run for, you know, if I sleep 1/3 of a second for some time, but nonetheless, it will quickly actually blast my RAM, my storage, and I will not get far. So that's actually, we're dealing with these dreams, but in principle, we will also not get far in an exact sort of fashion because we will quickly run out of storage to represent these objects. Okay, secondly, we now look at the implementation of this evaluation function. So here what I do is, let's maybe look at first at this term, right? Here is the cosine term. I work with this, the return value signature where I return both numerator and denominator. And I implement exactly what we saw before on the Wikipedia page, right? X is the input value. This was, I show it to you. There was x is taken to an even power. I flip the sign every time. So this is going to be n. In my notation, in this function, this is called k. N is k. And factorial of this 2n as well. And so this is exactly what you see here. This is the exact implementation. And this is not true anymore. But I think if I don't do this cast here with the integer, then this might be... this might be a float, I'm not sure. But in this case, I force it to be a rational number because this is this fraction library and this is an integer. And this stays a rational. And so here I have this evaluation thing. So I have this function which computes terms. In this case, this is actually, at each term is actually, since the cosine is an even function, but nonetheless, I basically always jump by 2. This is actually a doubly fast series approximation, Taylor series approximation of the cosine. And I get any stream with the right signature. So here we'll use the second Wallace product implementation. And what I do is I stream over this number, right? So at every yield, I get a better approximation of my number because this is a Cauchy sequence. And what I do is I also pop out where I'm at, like the index. And then I use this to do a polynomial approximation of this Taylor series up to n. So with this eval, I fuse both of these approximations. On the one hand, my number gets better because I use the Cauchy sequence, which gets closer and closer. And on the other hand, I use more and more terms in the Taylor approximation. The polynomials are more and more. And so in this way, I fuse this, like I can compute cosine of pi by moving up in pi and also moving up in cosine. The cosine is even doubly fast. So this approaches and cosine of pi is -1. So this must converge to -1 in the limit and it will look like it does. Okay. Then we have the main function, computes this stream and then I loop over the stream and print out this stuff. And that's what we're going to do now. I commented out the first main function because we're over that. It just looks like so. And maybe I also do this. Well, let's be slow. So here we see what happens. You know, it starts at cosine at 1, and then computes, and it after some time, you know, he's already like almost 10 and thousands at minus 1, and he will now approximate this better and better. However, if I can show you that if I do it with just very quickly print out these things, and now, you know, I have the index here, and you will actually see that it gets very quickly very slow because he cannot actually handle this, you know, this huge rational numbers with these huge factors and this more and more coefficients. So he doesn't really manage to get far anyway. And here now he, even though I basically don't like the sleeping time is like negligible, here it takes a second or so to compute every next entry. So this is the limitation of it all. This is the limitation of exact math, unless you like axiomize nice properties. The last thing I can show you is that if I print out, like, let's go back to 1 second, let's actually print this y return value of this cosine of pi as a rational. You can see how quickly this grow by, you know, of course, the Wallis product is like basically n factorial squared plus some exponential, and that is then plugged into this more and more higher order polynomial, right? It's crazy. Okay. So yeah, that's that. I hope you like that. If you're interested in reading Lie-algebra stuff and Lie groups as well, the book he's starting out lightly on the Lie group side. Then there's like a central chapter where he does the Lie-algebra thing. So the Lie group stuff is more like matrix groups as a manifold, and then the relation between Lie group and Lie-algebra, tangent space stuff. But then it comes sort of algebraic, hands-on. Chapter with it has a bunch of nice diagrams and classical algebra, like linear algebra proofs, before it goes back to doing more analysis then as well. So if you want to check it out or want to chat with me if you haven't before, I'm hanging out in this Discord, and have a nice evening.